Hello and welcome. You're watching Business Television India. I'm Shail Damania and you're watching Market Guru. The Market Guru for today is Sunil Subramaniam. He's the CEO at Sundaram Mutual. Very warm welcome to you. Overall, we've seen a lot of gyration in the markets. We've seen the drop from 11,000 levels on the Nifty all the way to 10,150. Now, a slight bit of a recovery coming back. Do you see the volatility decrease over the last few days, and is this something that one should extrapolate for the next couple of months, or you think the volatility is just here to stay for at least the next couple of months?
I think the volatility is here to stay for the next 6 months, yeah. Not just next couple of months, because both globally, economically, and domestically, politically,
right.
I think there's a volatility injection which is there. The economic recovery being fast or slow would impact inflation, interest rates, and FII flows. Domestically, the political results, Tripura came positive, market was happy, yesterday UP is negative, then Karnataka. So I think there is enough volatility related news out in the offing over the next 6 months, I would say. So I would not rule out the market touching new highs, market touching new lows in the next 6 months.
The last 1 week or 10 days has been reasonably stable, at least, if I may call it so, because a month ago, we used to see 100-point falls more often than not. Last 7-8 trading sessions have been slightly more stable. If you look at the overall picture, you think the most of the bad news which was coming through is pretty much captured into the price yet, or you see more room to go downward?
I think that it's not, when I say volatility, I don't mean bad news alone, right? Bad and good. Volatility is both highs and lows. So my perception is that the news itself is impactful. So whether it is bad news is priced in, good news is priced in, it leads to moves in the market. Second thing, where the important thing why I mentioned volatility is, to me, the volumes are going to be fairly thin in terms of the coming 6 months. That's another reason that any news flow would impact it. There's a reason I'm saying this is that normally, if you see over the last 3 years, right, FII flows, whenever they have sold, domestics have bought.
Right.
Because there's been strong inflows both in terms of lump sum and SIP for domestic. That's going to continue. The key is domestic fund managers will be reallocating portfolios at this period, because consumption, which was high value, high pick, PE pick, and the numbers have actually come out bearing that out, you will now find that incrementally they will shift into the infra, cap goods, more economic related thing. So this reallocation of the domestic fund managers flows will also lead to volatility in specific sub-segments, right? So what I'm saying is, what could be demand in one will make the prices go up, somewhere it will be down. So to me, wall is not equal to bad news. Wall is equal to the fact that there's good news plus bad news both coming in.
So, since you're from the mutual fund industry, how have you seen flows come through? We have seen a very good period in the last quarter of the last calendar year, and we have seen a very shaky period in the first 2.5-3 months in this year. As far as flows go into mutual funds, how have they been, not just for your company, but for the industry? Are you seeing investors get slightly skeptical of what's been happening and step back a bit, or the flow situation is the same?
I think the February numbers which came were higher than the January numbers for equity. So I don't see any panic situation from investors. There's been slow tapering of SIP flows at a kind of peak. The growth has been, this month's FI was slightly lower than last month, but that doesn't, it's not a fundamental shift in the market. It's more because the tax saving segment is where people now allocate money into the ELS schemes of mutual fund. That's been seeing a very strong inflow. So that's compensated for this small drop. So we are not seeing any panic reaction from investors. The money continues to flow. But this month, mutual funds have generally been selling a bit domestic, if you see the trend, purely because a lot of them are trying to book profits and pay dividends to investors.
Mm-hmm.
As you know, 31st March, dividends are tax-free.
Right.
From 1st April, the dividend distribution tax comes into play.
Right.
So there's an attempt by most mutual fund houses, wherever they have enough distributable surpluses, the SEBI rule says that you have to book cash profits to pay dividend. You can't pay from NAV appreciation.
Right.
Just book value appreciation. So there's been a little of selling right from the beginning of this month, only for that purpose, but so not from any negative view on the market.
So you expect that to continue into March?
31st March.
And no major runaway rally could be expected on the back of this?
Definitely not.
Okay. Alright, so this would be the main reason for where we are currently.
Correct.
And it's been reasonably stable, as I said, for the last 15 days or so. Another phenomenon which has been playing out is that last year, when you looked at the equity markets, any small good news, the markets would see very good upward jumps. That is pretty much stalled. And in fact, even when the good news has been coming in this year, so if you look at the last earnings season, if you look at the kind of GDP numbers which were recently given out, IIP numbers, and also, you know, on the geopolitical front, we had the Korea-US talks, you know, further go further in a positive manner. These were all good news items which the markets could have possibly reacted to well. It didn't happen. I mean, we did not see any kind of major cheer rallies coming through. So, does that give you a direction that, you know, we may taper down slightly more from current levels?
You got to drill down a little deeper,
right,
in both into international flows and domestic flows.
Right.
Let me address domestic flows first. See, the period from 2010 to 2000, last 10 years from 2004 to 14, saw less than 1 lakh crore come into mutual fund industry, but in the next 3.5 years, you've got 4 times that money come in. The point is that is tapering because the initial money comes from a reallocation from land, gold, fixed deposits into equities.
Mm-hmm.
Now that major reallocation has happened. Now it's the incremental earnings which people are getting, salaried employees who are putting through SIPs.
Mm-hmm.
So the big shift happened, and that's why last year the buoyancy came, because there was a huge shift from debt to equity happening, huge shift from physical to financial happening. Now that big shift has happened. Now it's the incremental flows which are coming in. So you can't expect that to continue, the growth trajectory of that kind of a shift to continue forever. While the flows will be healthy, you can't expect, there is no tapering in terms of the rate of the inflows growth. Right, we are now in a more stable environment. People are very reasonably confident about equity, they are collocating. But the debt equity ka shift jo hona tha, wo ho gaya.
But do you think it's over? You think that shift is completely over? You think money is still waiting on the sidelines to come in at maybe, say, 9,600, 9,700?
See, there could be, but the incremental impact of that will not be as huge as what happened earlier, is what I'm saying. For example, there was a 70-30 physical financial split, you know, in mid-2013-14. Today, it's already come down to 60-40.
Mm-hmm.
And by 2020, we expect to go to 55-45.
Mm-hmm.
So that's the shift. So the big move from 70 to 60 has happened. Now it's 60 to 55.
Right.
So that's what I meant. So there is still some money in lying in debt which could move to equities when the market corrects. But the magnitude of that is not as large as it was in the
right
past.
So the
that's the point in the domestic.
Though.
Internationally, you've got to be careful. Internationally, you see, FII money is basically three components, right? There's sovereign wealth funds and long-term pension funds, which look at the long-term economic outlook of an economy and allocate their resources there, right? Then there is the ETFs, which is people timing the market, people putting money into saying, abhi India acha hai, abhi ye acha hai. Third is the hedge funds, which is borrowed money coming into the markets. So the hedge fund is the hot money, the volatile tap. Now, when US economy good news comes in, right, it's actually mean inflation is going to go up. It means interest rates are going to, hikes are going to be there. So it means this hedge fund money becomes costlier.
Right.
So they would rather reallocate back into their own markets rather than put into this. Second thing, if the economic growth of the advanced economy is actually as good, then what's going to lead to is the commodity cycle is going to bounce, right?
Mm.
So because they will need commodities to fuel the growth. Now that means commodity rich emerging markets like Brazil, Russia, South Africa, their valuations will go up relative to a people rich economy like India.
Right.
So even FI, then he will reallocate. He's been also reallocating more to the commodity oriented countries rather than to the resource oriented, because the resource countries like people resource, the order book has to flow, exports have to then pick up, plants have to be set up. So it's a more longer term story. Whereas commodity, you'll see the gain immediately.
Mm-hmm.
So I think these two are the reasons that what the past you saw huge good news being Talia and markets coming, that's coming down, and there's a more stable kind of a.
Right. Interest rates for our own economy also, there are more murmurs that we are expecting them to see to go up than to be stable. Would that also be an indicator that money could shift from equity to debt in domestic?
Not really. There are two aspects here. One is the fact that why is the interest rates going to go up? Because demand for credit.
Mm-hmm.
Speaking up, which is very good news from an economy perspective, because the problem with the economy was there was no demand, nobody was borrowing to set up plants. With the consumption boom now happening, capacity utilization slowly creeping up. So as corporates now start to borrow to finance inventories, to finance capex, right, interest rates naturally will trend up.
Mm-hmm.
But that won't impact the flows, because still the equity markets can deliver at least a post-tax 50% higher return than your fixed income markets.
Right.
Right? I'm just saying there will be a 7-8% in the fixed income side. You're going to be a 10-12% on the equity side. It's still a 50% high. So that's not going to lead to a major reallocation from equity to debt. Highly unlikely.
Right.
And the second is, when interest rates rise, then G-Sex, if they rise, it's going to hurt the long-term duration play, right? So maybe the accrual funds will get some flows, but your duration play will actually lose flows because they would see capital erosion in the longer-term, gilt and long-term bond funds.
Fine. So, Mr. Subramaniam, then the next question is, what is a fair valuation? I know it's a very broad-based question, but let's look at a blue-chip company in the top 200, top 100, let's say a BSE 100 list, and a company which is growing, let's say, at 15% annually. What would be a fair valuation? How do you all approach this whole investment? And what is your own, chronology of research that you all do? So if for a retail investor who's watching and he wants to make an investment decision now, especially that the markets have fallen, what are the few things that you would advise him to look at?
So, in retail investors into mutual fund versus retail into equity markets.
Equity
Can
market.
You clarify which?
Equity market. So, if he is looking to buy, enter into a stock, because there are many stocks today in the consumption space which are doing very well for themselves, but they're also very expensive. So, what would be the few parameters that you could advise?
So, if you look at it, there are three ways that you make money from the stock market, right? There's top line growth, there's EPS growth, and there's PE rating.
Right.
Right. So the biggest money is made where PE rating happens. Right. Lesser money is money when EPS, even lesser money when you're on top line. So consumption, for example, is the fact that PE rating is hardly left to happen. Now most of the PE has been already anticipationally going up. So in consumption sector, if a company is growing at 15%, I would say the for you to expect a market return, right, I would say would be only 12-15% because the PEs are already reflecting.
Yeah.
Whereas if you take something like infra, there's still a huge price to book discount to the Nifty of the Nifty Infra Index. So if you are having an outlook of 3 to 5 years in your mind and you buy good quality infra companies, right, you could see a PE re-rating upside in addition to order book, top line. So all the three can go up. So I would say that investors should look at an outlook of time frame. Obviously, I'm not going to talk about somebody making a 12-month investment because 12 months is highly volatile. So I'm saying if you start with an 18-month period, right, and you look at a five-year period, I would say at 18 months to 36 months, right, consumption, rural area, agri, plus rural consumption, rural infra, and retail financing, because retail banks, private sector retail banks, and retail financing companies. These would be the sector which would deliver a decent 12-18% band, depending on where they are. But if they have a holding period of longer than 3 years, 3 to 5 years, I would actually ask them to allocate more to infra, to export-oriented sectors like IT, to corporate banks. I mean, I know public sector banks today are away, right? Because there's still a lot of risk, but there's private sector corporate banks which are there. So, because we see that the next leg of the growth for the market will be driven by the whole lending capacity creation, that kind of a leg, driven both by the government spend which is already in place, but by the fact that consumption is rising, capex capacity utilization rising. So, in 18 to 24 months, we'll expect private sector to start doing capex. So, order books of small and mid-cap companies which are going to supply that will start to swell. Their valuations will start to rise. So it's a good time to start allocating that, because on top of this will be the FDI, which the government is strongly encouraging. So when FDI physically comes as cash, then plants need to be set up. So right, cap good suppliers will come in, turbines, machines, suppliers. The third would be the economic revival of the advanced countries, means our export-oriented sectors are going to get, especially the labor-oriented, export-oriented sectors. So, if with a slightly longer-term outlook, I would say these kind of three categories, right, would be the ones that people should put their money into.
Right. So, the next major trigger, if it's positive or negative, we'll only know with time. But one would be the monsoons, and second would be the MSP prices, which will be announced in the next couple of months. How important will these two events be? And, will they be, in a sense, market moving? What is your own reading of this? Any sectors that you would look at ahead of these announcements and even ahead of the monsoon?
Yeah. So, essentially, if you look at it, the monsoon today, yes, monsoon is important in India because a primary driver of agricultural thing is the monsoon, right, in most pockets. So, I can't discount the monsoon. So, the news of the monsoon will be an impact, and that's a tukka, it's a head of heads or a tail situation. But the MSP story, right? So, there's a story in the MSP is that the 150% that the government announced in the budget, when we went down and looked at the crops individually, we found that more than half the crops, the MSP is already 150% plus. Hmm. So from an inflation impact, we don't expect this. This was more of a political announcement to reassure the farmers that your cost input is taken care of. So there will definitely be pockets where it will go up. Hmm. So we view that as a positive from the consumption space, because the farmers are going to get more money, rural consumption is going to get a big boost. So given the fact that it's a politically sensitive year with a lot of elections, we think that the diversion of money, when I say diversion, I mean in a good way, not in a bad way.
Right.
Allocation, that means the reallocation of money into the rural populace by the government, either through subsidy, through MSP, through road and job creation in rural India, is going to be stepped up. So I would say the impetus for a rural-based allocation should increase right now, independent of the monsoon.
Right. So which are the themes you are looking at within this? So do you feel that you know, mid-cap infrastructure companies which make roadways, could that be a sector to look at, or which are a few of the themes within this, what you just said?
So if you look at it, EPC contractors, capital goods supplies, auto ancillary, because all of the rural consumption driven, and auto ancillary has a double thing too. One is the top line growth of domestic auto, which is also coming strong, but also the international auto components is a huge export arm to it. So that's gets a boost from that. Mid-cap IT, because again, from a world economy recovering perspective, the need for IT is going to go up, but it's going to be new age IT. Not the traditional ITES BPO model, but more like artificial intelligence, cloud computing, Internet of Things. So these are the smaller and middle cap IT companies are more agile and positioned to capture this growth. So we would say actually mid cap IT companies, cap good suppliers in the infra space, EPC contractors, and auto and auto ancillary.
So you
and two commodities linked to the infra cycle, cement and steel.
Right. You spoke about auto companies which are exporting abroad, and also about IT. Now we've heard these protectionist measures coming out of US. You see that over a period of time, all these industries, even pharma included for that matter, get impacted by any of this. Maybe it may not happen in the near term, but we are hearing new and fresher noises. Just recently we had some duty increase on the shrimp exporters come through as well from the US. You see this as a threat developing over the next 3-4 months?
Undoubtedly, that's a threat, because every country is getting protectionist. So I think WTO, all those things are on the side. Started with Brexit. Continue with the Trump re-election. So the protectionist forces are there. But then what you need to analyze is that the theory of comparative advantage of nations based on lower cost of production, right? Mm-hmm. I think that's getting replaced by the point that everybody needs to create jobs at their local place.
Mm-hmm.
But the point is, what skill sets do the local people have to execute those orders? So if you see now, classically, if you take Trump and America, it's the Midwest belt, which was the Rust belt, it was called, right? Which was the manufacturing of steel plants, this, that. So IT is not something that they have a skill set for, nor that for. So I think if you look at it and segregate it, right, Trump did the major impact by reducing taxation on US corporations so that they do more of their revenue generation within America and pay a lower tax, right? So if you look at it now, what is the thing which would still benefit from this? A US corporation which comes to India, manufactures these products and re-exports it back into that country, right?
Yeah.
That's no problem. Because it's the US corporation, the tax money is going to be booked there, the taxation is going to happen there. They're just using the cheaper labor available in India to execute that order. So I think what you need to see, it's you can't use one rule fits all and just say that risk protection is it. Pharma, yes, we continue to be bearish on pharma, because there it affects the price to the consumer.
Mm-hmm.
Right? So there it's important as a vote bank. So I think once you understand the country's protectionist environment of A, creating jobs and making sure price increases are not there. So what is this whole trade war about, right? You are giving me cheaper goods, but you're not buying cheaper goods from me. So the resolution will come by an arrangement, a trade pact coming in, say, okay, I agree to buy so much of US products. In turn, you allow me to do this. So it's going to be a very practical, negotiated strategy. And I think that ultimately India's strength comes from the labor. The fact that our supply of labor is very high.
So how are you all placed on IT? Do you all have any IT stocks in the portfolio?
Yeah, and mid-cap.
More mid-cap IT stocks.
In the large cap, we do have some, but we are more mid-cap IT bullish.
Okay. Any other sectors that you all are preferring at the moment that you all have changed stance over the last couple of months?
Well, see, changing stance, the obviously the PSU banks has been a negative change in stance, right, thanks to
but
the...
But are you seeing value now that they have eroded so significantly?
Not yet, because we still need to see who the winners are. We still need to see whether there's some more bad news. We have absolutely no clue. You know, the lack of information from the public sector space of the what the NPAs are going to be, the amount of surprises which come. The fact that we don't expect so many public sector banks to remain in existence a year from now. I think that one of the main things which RBI is going to do is has to merge these banks and has to get the better quality banks running the poorer quality banks. Just too many banks. One of the reasons this happened is RBI just too many banks to monitor and manage. So you got to have, I think, small, lesser, bigger, healthier banks. So I think the next 6 to 9 months, you will see a lot of action happening on cleaning up, merger. So we rather wait to see who the winners are before we make an allocation. This is not the time for us to do value buying or bottom fishing at the
Don't enter yet. Just still a wait and watch kind of
still,
approach.
Still a wait and watch.
Metals, how are you placed on metals? Again, they are all more cyclical in nature. What is your view?
We were bearish of metals most of last year. We continue to remain bearish on there. The only metal where we are positive is steel, because it's got a link to the infra play. Right. Otherwise, from a pure metal as a momentum, but you know, play trading play, we are not yet turned around. We would watch the economic recovery in US and Europe, which could lead to the commodity, and metals are a part of that commodity pack. Then we would take call. But it's hard to, from a domestic play perspective, right? We still are not bullish on that
sector. FMCG?
FMCG, we believe that it's a safe bet. So to the extent that the safety component of our portfolios contains FMCG.
So also including the cigarette companies, alcohol companies, anything on that front, do you think that after GST things are slightly more normalized for these companies?
See, we look at it as a part of a broader consumption play, right? We don't have a specific view on a liquor or a specific view on cigarettes. We look at it as a part of a consumption play. And yes, I think from a consumption play, these are all positive. So we do have allocation to all of these sectors in our portfolio. But it's like more like in line with the index. It's not majorly overweight or underweight.
NBFC's stocks, you know, like even before this big fall came in this year, we had seen reasonably big corrections in December and then January. And the stocks have not come back yet. What do you make of this? If you minus the banks, more on the NBFC side, how are they looking currently?
I think the NBFCs, there are various categories of NBFCs. I think the housing NBFCs are ones who face a challenge because their cost of funding has gone up. While at the same time, banks are competing heavily on the sales front. But if you see the NBFCs which are into small and medium enterprise financing, we see the NBFCs which are, so those are, we are positive. The retail financing NBFCs, we are positive because we believe that they will continue to get a greater market share of the retail lending piece. So I think we are overweight on the NBFC space.
All right, Mr. Subramaniam, thank you so much for sharing time. Really appreciate it. And that was Mr. Sunil Subramaniam from Sundaram Mutual telling us about different facets of the markets, the pockets that he prefers at the current time. Thank you so much for watching.